say amen. It's good to be in God's house another Sabbath day. And let me say good morning or good early afternoon Central. It's my pleasure to stand here on behalf of Pastor and to be able to share the word with him. Just a few brief words of greeting and remark before we get into the message today. As always, we like to bring greetings from the conference office, which of course is right down the street, but we're always glad to represent the conference by bringing words of encouragement to the church. And our dear president, Elder William Cox, is actually in China right now. All of the conference presidents of Columbia Union were taken on a special trip sponsored, I believe, by Kettering Hospital. And they are over there. Well, they're probably not on the China Wall today, but worshiping there with our brothers and sisters in China. So I want to remember them in prayer, but we're happy for him and that experience. Also from our office, just a word from my department, youth ministry. Tomorrow is the traditional date that is set for the cotillion banquet, which is an opportunity for our young men and young ladies that are seniors to present themselves as they make the transition into adulthood in a traditional formal banquet. But due to some unfortunate circumstances, we have to postpone that event, and we're looking for a date that we believe we have secured for June. So you will hear more about that, and that will give a few more of our seniors, if we have any high school seniors, an opportunity to participate. We certainly did not want to cancel it altogether, because this is an opportunity for young people to raise scholarship money. And of course, we know that they are in need of that. So we ask for your prayers for that ministry. But though it is not taking place this week, by the grace of God, it will take place in June. Also, I would be a dead man when I get home today if I did not remind everyone of AY today at 6:30. The AY department is presenting a special program presented by our health and temperance department. And the question is, are you healthier than a fifth grader? We're going to find that out this afternoon at 6:30. So we want you to come back today. And I thought we were not going to have prayer for Fluffy, but Fluffy's prayer got in today. Amen. Aren't we happy for dear Fluffy? Some of you don't know what I'm talking about. That's all right. Okay. But God is good. Let's come together for prayer, though, now. I am, again, grateful for this opportunity to present. And when the pastor asked me to bring the word today, I thought of some things that I was working on. But the Lord impressed me to bring this message for this day, for this season, and that some, and I pray that all, would be in need of this word. So we bring this to you today. But let's pray now. Our Father and our God, we thank you so much for your tremendous love to us. Matchless love. Love that is so deep it is incomprehensible. And throughout the ages of eternity, we'll be learning of how deep that love is. We pray that we would experience that today as we look into your word. And yet I pray that, as always, you will challenge us with the urgency of the times of which we live in. Now, Lord, I realize that I am but a man and a sinner saved by grace, as everyone here. Unworthy to not just speak the word, but even to say your name. But through the grace of Jesus Christ and the gift of his death on Calvary, I ask that you would cleanse me from any unrighteousness, both in my record and in my heart, that I might be a vessel through which you might speak today, and that your people would be touched and lives will be changed and glory would be given to you and to you alone, for you deserve it only. I pray now that your spirit would rest upon this congregation. In Jesus' name, and for his sake. Amen. Our message this morning is entitled, What Price of Sacrifice? What Price of Sacrifice? I am a topical preacher most of the time, and I love defining words that will help us to understand what is the theme of the message. I believe a good sermon, if you leave the congregation and somebody said in one word, what did he speak about? If you can say that one word, I've done my job. And in one sentence, what did he say? If you can say that one sentence, I think I have done my job. So the theme of this message today is sacrifice. What price of sacrifice? And I want to define that for us, first of all. Sacrifice could be a verb or a noun. As a verb, a sacrifice is the offering of an animal, plant, or human life, or some material possession to a deity as in propitiation or homage. In other words, as a gift in your worship. It is the act of offering something, of giving something. It is also a noun. A sacrifice is the thing that is offered in the previous definition. It is a person, animal, or object surrendered, destroyed, killed, or offered. The thing, the noun, is also a sacrifice. A sacrifice is in business. In business, it is a loss incurred in selling something below its supposed value. You know, they'll have some guy on the television and says, we're slashing prices and we're going bankrupt and come and buy something. And we're just letting things go as if he was selling them below its value. A sacrifice is also in chess. We have any chess players? Anybody play chess? You know what a sacrifice is. In chess, a sacrifice is a move of giving up a piece in hopes of gaining tactical or positional compensation in other forms. You give up your knight in order to get your opponent's queen. Can I get a witness here today? Somebody knows what I'm talking about. It's called a sacrifice. And then there's a sacrifice in baseball. A sacrifice in baseball is a sacrifice or a sacrifice bunt is a batter's act of deliberate bunting the ball in a manner that allows the runner on base to advance to another base. Your team is down in the bottom of the ninth inning and you need a run and you give the signals, the coach gives the signal and says, bunt the ball. Now, the batter really wants to swing a home run, but the object is that we at least need to tie the game. And if there's a runner on first, it's not good enough. They have what is called scoring position. Scoring position is second or third base because if there is a hit while the runner is at second or third, it's a possibility he can run all the way home and tie the game up. So the batter who is at bat when receiving the signals from the coach at third base decides that he's going to bunt the ball or is required to bunt the ball to allow another runner to advance. He gives himself up so that somebody else can advance. It's called a sacrifice. In fact, in baseball, when you sacrifice, it doesn't even go against your batting average. But here's the best definition. A sacrifice is the act of giving up, foregoing, surrendering or destruction of something highly prized or desired for the sake of something or someone else. Let me say that again. It is the act of giving up, foregoing, surrendering, or the destruction of something highly prized or desired for the sake of something or someone else. Now, that word sacrifice is, you know, everybody pretty much knows what it means. And if you didn't, I've given enough definition to explain that to you today. But we live in a society that does not enjoy that word. We live in a society that is very self-serving. We desire a life of comfort and ease. And yet, though it takes sacrifice to get there, once we get there, we often don't like to sacrifice. We know what the word means, but it's foreign to our society's way of thinking. We live in a me generation, our society. It's all about me. I know of a song that's sung around Christmas time, and the little girl sings the song, and the song goes like this. The little girl says, gimme, 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 gimme that thing, gimme this, gimme, gimme that, gimme this thing, gimme that, gimme this, gimme that thing. Oh, gimme, 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 gimme that thing, gimme this, gimme that, gimme that thing, gimme this, gimme that, gimme that thing. Oh, gimme. And that's all she does. She just continues to sing, gimme this, give me that, because it's all about me. It's not about the other person. I remember as a Pathfinder growing up during Thanksgiving time, you know, we'd all go out and we gather canned goods and we knock on the door. Hello, sir. My name is Joel Johnson. I'm a member of the Glenville Seventh Adventist Church Pathfinder Club, and we're gathering canned goods for needy families. Would you please help us out? And you know what those folks would do? They'd say, okay, son. And they'd say, wait right here. And they'd go back in the house and back in the kitchen and go into the pantry and pull out a can of beets. After blowing the dust off of it. Probably didn't know they had it, but they'd reach up and get a can of beets and put it in the basket and say, there you go, little boy. God bless you. As if they have sacrificed. Or if a family, and let's say there's a fire and a family is burned out and it's, oh, the family, they lost everything and they need everything. They need clothes and everything else. And some people will go up in their attic and they'll pull out a pair of old bell-bottom pants and an old shirt with a high boy collar that you wouldn't be caught dead in out of the attic and think that they had sacrifice. There's a little song of a little poem of a little person who says, I had a tea party. I had a little tea party this afternoon at 3. 'Twas very small, 3 guests in all, just I, myself, and me. Myself ate all the sandwiches, I drank all the tea. 'Twas also I who ate the pie and passed the cake to me. Selfish. We live in a society that doesn't think in terms of sacrifice. And again, let's look at that definition. Sacrifice is the act of what? Giving up, foregoing, surrendering, or the destruction of something what? Highly prized or desired for the sake of something or someone else. And I ask you this morning, what price of sacrifice? Let's go to our scripture reading today, and it's in Mark chapter 10 and verse 13 to 27. It should be large enough for you to read there. And I'm going to read this to you. It's Mark chapter 10, verse 13 to 27, but I'm going to read it, and you don't have to read along. You can listen or whatever as we go. And here the Bible says, and they brought young children to him that he should touch them. And his disciples rebuked those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased and said unto them, suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein. And he took them up in his arms and put his hands upon them and blessed them. And when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and knelt to him and asked him, good master, what shall I do that I might inherit eternal life? And Jesus said unto him, why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. Thou knowest the commandments, Jesus says, do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and thy mother. And he answered and said unto him, Master, I have observed all these things from my youth. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him and said unto him, one thing thou lackest. Go thy way, sell whatever thou hast, and give it to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come, take up the cross, and follow me. And he was sad at that saying, and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. And Jesus looked round about and saith unto his disciples, how hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? And his disciples were astonished at his words. But Jesus answereth again and saith unto them, children, how hard is it for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to inherit the kingdom of God. And they were astonished out of measure, saying amongst themselves, well, who then can be saved? And Jesus, looking upon them, saith, with men it is impossible, but not with God. For with God all things are possible. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of that word. Let's look at the story here. Here's the picture of Jesus with children. I imagine Jesus had been preaching and was tired. The sun is beating down on him. The road is dusty. And the disciples who have his back are trying to, you know, give Jesus a little bit of break. I mean, he's human. You know, and he's tired and he just needs a little break so he can rest. People are just coming and going and pushing and shoving. So they kind of pull everybody back and say, hey, y'all get back, man. Get a man a rest. Yeah. You know, and while they're doing that, while they're up here doing that, the little children are down there slithering through their legs, getting up there, and they run up to where Jesus is. And before the disciples know it and they turn back, they see all these children all over Jesus. And they say, hey, you kids, you all get away from there. Get a man a break. And Jesus said, oh, no. Always have time for children. Actually, he always has time for everybody. But he says, you got to let the children come. There's something special about the innocence of a child. And Jesus is talking to them. And there is a dynamic connection that is just so amazing that's going on between Jesus and the children. And there's something between the eyes of Jesus and the eyes of the children that is just so powerful. You've noticed that when certain people look at certain people a certain way, you know there's a chemistry, there's a kinesthetic power going on, and that's going on between Jesus and the children, and he's talking to them, and he's touching them, and he's kissing them, and he's blessing them. And while all this is going on, the Bible relates in this story that there is one young man from a distance who's watching and observing all of this. He is amazed by the dynamic between Jesus and the children. Finally, Jesus says, well, kids, I got to go. So y'all be good and honor your father and your mother and praise God. And he blesses the children and he gets up and Jesus begins to walk away. The Bible says this person that was watching came running to Jesus. Then he kneels before Jesus. Now, you know, mama taught you don't be running after no man. But this person runs and kneels, and then he declares, good master, rabbi, great teacher. And he asks the question, what can I do that I might inherit eternal life? What is it that I must do? Now, this question is a Pharisaical question. It is a question that this man offers based upon his background. His background is that he is a Pharisee. And Pharisees believe in the idea that if we work hard and do everything right, it is almost that our own acts of righteousness will save us. Righteousness by works. It's Pharisaical. That's why he says, what must I do in order to be saved? And you as a Christian, you ought to know there's nothing that you can do to be saved. It's all what Jesus has done. But in his background, background, he asked the pharisaical question, what must I do? He expects Jesus to offer him a certain list of things he must accomplish in order to receive eternal life. And Jesus deals with him from the background of which he comes from. That guy comes from a salvation by work, salvation by law. So Jesus throws the law right back up in his face. You honor thy father and mother. Don't kill. Don't steal. Don't bear false witness. Don't commit adultery. Don't covet. And the young man, he thinks and says, well, wait a minute. I've done all those. I am faithful. I am a good. Now, he doesn't say I'm a good Pharisee, but in his mind, he says, all these things I have done, and I have done them from my youth. Please understand this, ladies and gentlemen. This is a generational member of the church. He's not a new convert. You know, some of you and I pride ourselves that we're third and fourth generation Adventist or Christian or whatever you are. Well, this is a generational person. He's been in the church a long time. And he says that from my youth, even though he is a young man, I have done all these things. And yet, something was missing. Something was missing. I must ask a question to you today. As this young man asked the question, what must I do to attain eternal life? This young man, when he got the answer, when he asked a question and he realized there was something missing, I must ask you today, and I'm talking to you, that whether you are new in the Christian faith or new in the church or you're a generational member of this church, is something missing? Now, I want you to think about that. There's something missing. Is there something that keeps your joy fluctuating? Many of us have a fluctuating relationship with God or a fluctuating experience of joy and peace. It comes and it goes. We're up and we're down. Our relational experience with God is as a roller coaster. Now, I love a good roller coaster. But not in my life and my relationship with God. Sometimes it's up and then, oh, sometimes it's down and then, oh, it's up and then, oh, it's down. Some of our relational experiences are like a roller coaster. Something is missing. And you've been in the church a long time. You're a pillar of the church. You were here when Central was started. Your mama and daddy were Adventists way back in 1920-something-something. You know everything. You've been to all the schools. You've been to CAA and Old Ephesus Academy, and you went to Pine Forge and Mount Vernon and Oakwood and Andrews and Washington and Loma Linda and all that. You know the Sabbath school lesson. But something's missing. You was here before the deacons got here this morning to open the door. Something's missing. You know all the recipes from Loma Linda, Cedar Lake, and Worthington. Something's missing. You know every hymn. You know sometimes they sing songs and somebody said, have you ever heard that hymn before? You know all the hymns. But something's missing. And I'm asking you this seriously now. I'm not just doing preacher stuff. Is something missing? This young man realized that something was missing in his life. This ruler had a high estimation of his own righteousness. He didn't really suppose that he was defective in any way, and yet he was not altogether satisfied. He wanted something that he did not possess. Something was missing. He realized that the children had what was missing in his life. When he looked at the relationship between Jesus and the children, he saw a dynamic that was missing in his life. So it's running up to Jesus as a response to that chemistry between Jesus and the children. Now, this person is known as the rich young ruler. We never get his name, and I'll tell you a little bit later why we never get his name. But he's known as the rich young ruler. He had everything in life that you want. You don't believe it? He had everything. He was rich. He was young. And he was powerful. That's what everybody wants in this life. To be rich. Can I get an amen? Is there anyone here today that has so much money, it has brought you so much woe and sadness, you're just looking for a place to dump it all? The deacons will be willing to come back up and take another collection. But most of us feel like we don't have enough, and we want more, and we want more, and we'll work overtime, and we'll work double time, and we'll sell a little Amway on the side, and we're trying to get a little internet business going so we can get more money, money, money. We want more. I'm not saying it's right. I'm just saying that's human nature. We want more. So he's rich. He was number two. He was young. Young, prime of life, probably a little bit before the prime of life. Had all his own hair. His own hair. Because, you know, when we don't get it, we'll go and buy some. Had all his own teeth. Didn't need any glasses or bifocals or, you know, the invisible lines. Can I get a witness? You know, we didn't want those bifocals. We don't want that. If it didn't matter, you wouldn't get the invisible line. You know that's the truth. We want to be young. We want to stay young. We want to look young. Nothing worse than an old person trying to dress young. You know what I'm talking about. I ain't calling out no names. I'm not going there. But we want to be young. Everybody wants to be young. Now, young kids, you want to be a little bit older so you can drive. We understand that. But everybody wants to be young. He had the six-pack. Strong, handsome, good looking. He had what we want. And then the third thing, he was powerful. He was a ruler. He was a member of the Sanhedrin. He was a man of authority. He had servants under him. If he wanted something, he would say, go there and get that and bring it back and do that and move that and find that and go there. Man of authority. You know, psychology says that the greatest desire of mankind is not money. It is not sex. It's power. To be the HNIC. You know what I'm talking about. That's the greatest desire, to have power, to be in charge. You know, did you know that there are some churches where people fight for offices? I ain't gonna go there. Because people want power. He had everything he wanted, and yet something was missing. Something was missing. So the Bible says in verse 21, then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. I get the picture that the young man is all excited. Well, what must I do to be saved? And Jesus said, what do you do? And the young man said, well, all these things I've done for my youth. And he's all excited and he's ready. I did everything Jesus said. What must I do? And the Bible says, then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. In other words, Jesus stopped and gave him that parental stare. You all know what I'm talking about. When your kids really aren't listening, so you just stop talking and you just kind of like. But I imagine the difference is with Jesus' face, it is a look of love and compassion. But he stops. He pauses with a little bit of silence. Whereas the young man probably thinks he's going to start talking, but Jesus just pauses and looks at him. And in that moment of silence, he gets his full attention, along with the attention of everybody who's standing around, beholding him. Then the Bible says he loved him. The most important words this young man would ever hear, listen to what I'm saying. The most important words this young man would ever hear were about to be ushered to him. That's why Jesus pauses. That's why Jesus looks him dead in his eye. Gains his attention. He shows him a look of love. And then he says, one thing thou lackest. Let me pause for a moment. This young man was going through the crises of his life and didn't know it. He didn't know it. It's like Esau. You remember Esau and Jacob? When Esau sold his birthright for a bowl of stew, chili? We are told he was going through the crisis of his life and he didn't know it. The decision that he made in selling his birthright affected his life for the rest of his life and for eternity. The crisis of his life and he didn't know it. Felix heard the word. His response was, go away. Come back at a more what? Convenient time. In the crises of his life, ladies and gentlemen, somebody sitting in Central are in the crises of your life by this sermon, and you may not even know it. The decision that someone's going to make, and I'm telling you, I'm bringing an appeal today. The decision somebody makes today may determine whether you will be saved or lost. I'm sure that Felix thought that later on, that's why he said, come back for a more convenient time. I know that Esau thought, I'll sell him the birthright for a bowl of beans today, and I'll make him some potholders, and he'll give me the birthright back tomorrow. No! This is the crisis of his life. That's why Jesus stopped. That's why Jesus looked at him. That's why Jesus said, look, one thing you lack. Three commands to see the one thing missing. Jesus says this, go thy way, sell whatever thou hast and give it to the poor, and thou shalt have riches in heaven. Then he says, come, take up the cross and what? And follow me. This answer blew him away. I mean, this young man was blown away from the, again, he's a Pharisee. He thought he was going to tell him to do something, like go build something, go give something. This answer blew him away. But I want you to understand, he was not confused at the answer Jesus gave him. He was not confused. He was not confused at what Jesus was asking him to do. In fact, he immediately saw what stood in his way. He was blown away, but he was not confused. He just was not prepared for that answer from Jesus. With his money, he was used to buying what he did not have. With his youth, he possessed the strength and energy to get whatever he did not have. With his power, he was used to sending a servant or giving commands to fetch what he did not have. The rich young ruler, your money can't buy this one. It's not for sale. Your good looks won't get you by this time. He, Jesus, is unimpressed. Your authority is not recognized here. Take up your cross and follow me. Let's look at that. Let's look at that. Number one, he says, go thy way and sell whatever thou have and give it to the poor. The poor was to surrender, give it to the poor, was to surrender all the material things that he loved more than he loved God. You see, money is not the root of all evil, even though he was rich. There was no sin in being rich. It was, of course, you know, the what? The love of money. When Jesus says, go thy way and sell whatever thou have, it was because his material possession, his wealth, he loved more than he loved God. God doesn't tell every rich person to give away all his money. But to those who want eternal life, if you love it more than God, it has to go. You cannot serve God and mammon. His possessions had become his God. And I want you to understand, here's a note. Anything you love more than God is your God. Anything you love more than God. Can I get a witness in that? Now let me break that down. Let me see how much you still want to testify. Anything you love more than God is your God. And how you can tell, you know, we sometimes always think that we are not violators of the first commandment. You know, the first commandment says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. And we, most of us, feel pretty good about that one. Say, I don't have any gods before God because I don't be worshiping no idols, you know. No. Ladies and gentlemen, like this young man, we're guilty of that violation of the first commandment. You remember when Jesus told him all the things he had to do, he read the last six. He didn't read the first four. Young man couldn't testify of that. The young man loves things more than God. And here's the test. The test of that which is loving more than God. The reason why many of us are violators of the first commandment is that we have other gods, is because whatever gets the most of your leisure is your God. Whatever gets the most of your leisure is your God. Break it down a little bit more. Whatever gets the most of your leisure time is your God. Whatever gets the most of your leisure money is your God. Whatever gets the most of your leisure energy is your God. Whatever gets the most of your leisure talent is your God. Whoever gets your Now, what does leisure mean? Leisure means it is discretionary. You can do whatever you want to do with it. Now, when you get your paycheck, let's deal with round numbers. If you get your paycheck, let's say your paycheck is $1,000. And you got you may give tithes, which is 100, and you're 10 and 10 and offering 100. That leaves you with 8. But your mortgage is 400. Now, you didn't give God 200, but your mortgage is 400. Is your mortgage God? No. Because it's not leisure money. You got to pay your mortgage or else you'll be sleeping in the streets. That's not leisure money. Leisure money is not paying your bills, not paying your responsibilities, not paying the things that you're supposed to pay. Leisure money is after all the bills have been paid. And you got something left over. What do you do with that? That's leisure money. And so sometimes we use our leisure money, and so you might return your tithe. Let me deal with tithe. You may return your tithe, which is 10%. That's a bill. That's a requirement of God. Amen? Tithe, 10%. That's a requirement of God. And then you got to pay your mortgage. What's the next highest bill most of us have? Car note. Got to pay your car note because they will come and take that car back. I'm a witness. You got to pay your car note, and you got to pay your gas and your water bill and your electric bill and all those things you got to have, right? Then whatever you have left, you decide what you're going to do. So I returned my tithe, I paid my regular standard bills and whatnot, and then I got some money left over. Who gets the lion's share? And I tell you this, and I challenge anybody, and we'll stop and discuss it right now. If your cable bill is more than you put in the offering plate, tell me who your God is. Some of you pay $100 a month to Time Warner, Viacom, Dish Network, DirecTV, and feel hurt when you put $20 in the offering plate. Tell me who your God is. That's leisure money. I say this and I challenge somebody, and we'll stop now the discussion. You're on your way to hell if your cable bill is more than you put in the offering plate. Anybody want to challenge? We'll take a few moments. Ladies and gentlemen, what you do with your leisure, because see, you don't have to have that. That's something you want. Something you don't even need. But you decided you want that, and the church is suffering. And I'm not trying to do, I'm not preaching a stewardship message today. I'm talking about your relationship with God. What do you do with your leisure time? Now, if you're a young person and you go to school, you spend 6 to 7 hours in school every week. Every day, excuse me, every day. And then you come home. Now, if you come home after spending 6 or 7 hours in school or 8 hours working, then you got house chores. You got to clean the house, clean the bathroom, wash the dishes, do the lawn. All that stuff that has to be done. Then you got a block of time left. Who gets the lion's share of that block of time left? That leisure time. Is it Nintendo? And folks, I'm not saying this stuff to be funny. I'm serious, a heart attack. Who gets the lion's share of your leisure time? Is it NBC, CBS, ABC, ESPN? Or is it God and the Sabbath school lesson? Or your own personal devotion? If you spend 3 or 4 hours in front of the tube and don't spend 10 minutes in the Word of God, please let me know who your God is. Y'all don't like this, but it's the truth anyhow. The question is, what must I do to obtain eternal life? And that is, you must get rid of any other God. When Jesus said, take what you have and sell it and give it unto the poor, it was because money had become his God. Money was more important than Jesus. What we do with our leisure time and whatnot, I'm going to have to go on. To surrender all the material things that he loved more than God is what Jesus was saying when it came to take what you have, sell it, and give it to the poor. Then he says, take up the cross. What does take up the cross mean? Take up the cross was to give up his honored seat on the council and renounce a life of comfort and ease and pleasure and accept, when necessary, an uncomfortable, unpopular life. See, we all like ease. But when Jesus says, take up the cross, ladies and gentlemen, he's talking about taking up the cross. Now, not the literal cross. But when you're going to gain eternal life, you've got to be willing to accept an uncomfortable, unpopular way of life. And again, the nature of us is that we want to be comfortable and we want to be popular. We want everybody to like us. If you're at school, if you're at work, in your neighborhood, you want everybody to like you. It ain't going to happen as a child of God always. In fact, most of the times it won't. In fact, it won't. In fact, those who live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer the persecution and ridicule of others. Jesus says to this young man, you're popular. Everybody wants to follow you around and talk to you. And you're a big shot. But he said, no, take up the cross. Take up the cross. Accept an unpopular, uncomfortable life, no fame and no fortune. That's what he says we must do. Many people say, in fact, if we read in Mark chapter 10 and verse 38, when Jesus responds to all of this, you know, the disciples talk about, oh, Lord, we done left everybody to follow you. And all this, Jesus said, yeah, you do a big talk, but can you drink from the cup? Can you drink from the cup that I must drink from? Not one of popularity, not one of fame, not one of fortune, not one of comfort, not one of ease. Are you willing to drink from the cup? You want eternal life, but not what it takes to in order to achieve the eternal life. Then lastly, Jesus says, you must follow me. To follow me is to let go of your plans, your self-serving goals, and submit yourself to his way. It calls for, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, an immediate decision. When Jesus says, tell whatever you have, give it to the poor, and thou shalt have riches in heaven, and take up the cross, then he lastly says, you must follow me. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus is not saying, I want to hear from you in a couple of weeks what you're going to do. Jesus said, you must follow me now, on the spot. An immediate decision without delay. That's why he was blown away. The young man knew exactly what Jesus wanted. But he weighed it in the balances of his mind. You know, like scales, he weighed it. What Jesus was offering him with eternal life and what Jesus was asking him to do and what he possessed and what Jesus was asking him to give up and do. He weighed it in the balances of his mind. And listen to this, ladies and gentlemen. He came to the conclusion that Jesus was asking him to give up too much. Jesus, you're asking me to give up too much? You're asking me to give up too much? Too soon. I'm a young man. I'm young and I'm single and I still want to mingle. I'm a young guy, man. Maybe later on I'll come back, but Lord, I can't give all this up now. I'm just starting to live. I ain't even got married yet. I don't have all the stuff I want. You asking me to give this up now? Then, ladies and gentlemen, I read what I believe is the saddest text in the Bible. Personally, saddest text in the Bible when it deals with people. The Bible says in verse 22 of Mark chapter 10, the Bible says, and he went away sad at that saying, for he had great possessions. He weighed in the balances of his mind and came to the conclusion Jesus asked him too much, too soon, the price of sacrifice that he would have to make in order to have eternal life is too high. He gave Jesus the biggest insult that you could pay to anybody. I'm going to tell you something, how to be a bad person. You want to be mean? I'll tell you how to be mean. You got to forgive me for this one. I'm going to tell you how to be mean. If you ever get in an argument with somebody and you're losing the argument, I'm going to tell you how to win. You're losing an argument. You go, rah, 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 and they go, rah, 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 and you go, rah, 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 and they go, rah, 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 and you just can't win the argument and you want to win. This is what you do. When they go, rah, 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 you do like this. The biggest insult you can pay to somebody is to ignore them, is to turn your back on them. You always win. So if you lose an argument, just turn and walk away. Now, you might get hit in the back of the head, but that's another story. But if you want to win, you ignore them. That's the biggest insult. No words can compare to just ignoring somebody. And this young man paid. Jesus was offering him eternal life. But he paid him the biggest insult by walking away. What he lacked was true love of God. And again, ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking to most of you because most of you are generational Christians or generational Adventists. Some of you are not, and I understand that. Some of you may not even be Adventists or may not even be Christian. But in general, we have been a part of the Christian faith a long time, and we have a love for God. Boy, when they were singing that song today, y'all were just standing and singing and clapping and having a wonderful time. That's easy. I mean, the song was good now. I'm not saying that you didn't deserve. They were singing the song. They were playing those instruments. But that's the easy part. There is a type of love that is superficial or that may be deemed superficial. It may be seen by the appearances of the outside. But true love is not by what you say. It's by what you do. Because there's a lot of scoundrels who have said, baby, baby, I love you. Love is not what you say. It's what you do. This young man had the appearance of righteousness, but he lacked true love. God was second in his heart. And you'll never have eternal life, ladies and gentlemen, if God is number two. He must be number one. He was a slave to his own covetousness. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, the rich young ruler loved God, but He loved his possessions more. The servant of the Lord says this: many will be lost desiring to be saved. That's powerful. The desire to be saved will not get you saved. We all want to be saved. Who wants to go to hell? We all want to be saved, but there's a difference that's got to be. God must be number one. We can't serve God and man and our possessions. I remember the story of an older man that I had the pleasure of baptizing, and he was talking. We were had a prayer meeting, and they were giving testimonies, and we're talking about all the things that people were talking about, how God had been blessing him. And this older gentleman had never given a testimony because he just felt a little nervous. But then he finally realized that he had to say something. He couldn't go to prayer meeting every night and hear all the sisters testify and he not testify. So he got up and began testifying. He started saying, "Well, you know, before I joined the church and became a Christian, I lived a scoundrel's life, but I gave it all up when I came to Jesus." All the saints was getting excited. Oh, he said, before I joined the church, I used to smoke 2 packs of cigarettes a day, but I gave it all up when I joined the church. All the saints were starting to stir. He said, "I used to drink a fifth of liquor every day. I'd go through a 6-pack like it was nothing. But I gave it all up when I came to Jesus." Oh, the saints were getting happy. He said, "I used to eat pork and chitlins and barbecue ribs and all the rest of that. But I gave it all up when I joined this church." Oh, the saints were just waving their hands. He said, "Yeah," he was feeling good. Then he said, "Before I joined the church, I had women all over town. I had a woman on the north side and a woman on the south side. I had girlfriends on the east and on the west. But I gave it all up." Think of talking about sacrifice. "I gave it all up when I came to Jesus." He finished that all. The saints were just applauding. "Amen, brother, amen." And I'm sitting there thinking, he ain't give up, excuse my Ebonics, he ain't gave up nothing but a headache. No, in reality, he did give up something. When he gave up cigarettes, he gave up emphysema and lung cancer. When he gave up liquor, he gave up a burned out stomach lining, a destroyed central nervous system, and high insurance rates. When he gave up pork and chitlins and fat back and ribs and all the rest of that, he gave up trigonosis worms and high blood pressure. When he gave up the woman on the north side of town, he gave up syphilis. And the one on the south side of town, gonorrhea. And the one on the east side of town, AIDS. And the one on the west side of town, his wife chasing him all over town. When you come to Jesus, it may seem like you're giving up a lot and it's a sacrifice, but you ain't giving up nothing but a headache. In fact, I love the way the Bible says, one of my favorite texts, Psalms 84:11. The Bible says, "For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory." Read that last part with me. "No good thing will he withhold from them who walk upright." If it's good, he doesn't tell you to leave it alone. All the things that God says don't eat, don't drink, don't do are things that are bad for you. "No good thing will he withhold from them who walk upright." The problem with the young man with the money is that he loved money more than God, so it became a bad thing. But you know, when you do this, when you come so that we may think it's hard to give up, we may think it's a big sacrifice to become a Christian or to join the church. In fact, that's why a lot of people are not Christians, because they don't want to give up things. Of course, they got a lot of churches now that say you can be a Christian and still don't have to give up anything. I have question with that. But ladies and gentlemen, if you think it's hard to be a Christian, try being a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. You talk about sacrifice. It's hard being an Adventist. Come on, say amen. Because your friends that are Christians, they can do a lot of stuff that you can't do. You know, when you join the Adventist church, oh Lord, can't go here. Can't go there, can't do this, can't do that. What we eat, what I wear, where I go, what music I listen to, what movies I watch. Man, it's a lot you have to give up to be an Adventist, isn't it? Is that true?
Don't like it, it's the truth. We have a standard, a high standard. And we're going to uphold the standard. That's old school. Old school going to uphold the standard. Can't talk about young school. We're going to uphold the standard. And you got to give all this up to become an Adventist. You even got to be dunked completely under the water in the baptismal pool. You know, you just can't even sprinkle a little water on top of my head and then say that's it. You got to get wet. Got to go all the way down and all the way back up. You just had your hair did. When you join this church, there is a sense of sacrifice like no other church requires or demands. People don't like that, though. Again, as I said, we don't like sacrifice. Like the church of the fourth century, that when Constantine legalized Christianity, people wanted to water down the faith. They didn't want to have the requirements. They started changing the rules because the laws of the church were demanding too much, and they began to water it down. The ideal is that maybe Jesus is asking you to give up too much. Lord, I want to be saved. But you're asking me to give up too much. I want eternal life, but I can't see that. Why I gotta give up all this? And that's a lot. You know, I can. You know, when I talked about just a moment ago, when this old man had to give up all these things, he gave up things that we all know is bad. You know, smoking cigarettes and smoking weed and drinking alcohol and all that other, running around with women all over the time. You know that's wrong. But when you join the Adventist church, sometimes you got to give up stuff you don't see anything wrong with. I love the way the Bible says it there in Mark chapter 10, same chapter. When Jesus responds to the disciples, he says this. The disciples came and answered and said, oh, Lord, we didn't give up a lot to follow you. He said, Jesus answered and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, no man have left his house or brethren or sisters or fathers or mothers or children or lands for my sake and the gospel, but he shall receive what? 100-fold when? In heaven? In the sweet by and by? No, the Bible says we will receive 100-fold blessing for whatever we give up in this present time. Houses and brethren and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecution, and in the world to come, eternal life. In other words, there's some things we give up we know we're better off without. Amen? But the other things we don't see it, God said, do it anyway. Trust me, and I will reward you 100-fold in this time. You see, ladies and gentlemen, I have actually come to the conclusion in What Price of Sacrifice that whatever we give up in this life, it's really no sacrifice. It really isn't, to me, a sacrifice. So many of us want heaven, but we still want this world. I loved old Marshall Kelly used to sing the song, and he still does, some want a crown, but they won't bear their cross. But it takes everything to serve the Lord. Some want bright mansions, but they won't pay the cost. It takes everything to serve the Lord. It takes your hands and your heart and your head. It takes your all. It takes everything to serve the Lord. It takes your time and your means and your prayers lest you fall. It takes everything to serve the Lord. Some want to be somewhere his name, but they still live in shame. They want to be seen, but they don't want to live clean. It takes everything. And so I must ask the question, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone. And there's a cross for me. Here's two texts that help us out as we move to conclusion. Philippians 3:8 says, yea, doubtless I count all things but what? Loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered loss in all things and do count them but dung that I may win Christ. No sacrifice. That's what Paul says. James 1 says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience. So I ask you, is Jesus asking you to give up too much? Is the price of sacrifice that high? Again, I conclude, whatever we give up in becoming a Christian, becoming an Adventist, or becoming whatever,
for the cause of Jesus is really no sacrifice, because we're better off without it, or he'll reward us. It is investment of which will he'll reward us 100-fold in this life. There's really only one sacrifice. See, a sacrifice is giving up, foregoing, destroying something highly prized for something or someone else. The only real sacrifice was on Calvary. That sacrifice. They brought him as if he was an offender and a lawbreaker. They brought him as if he had done wrong.